friends and family. As always, happy Sabbath, and we want to thank you for tuning in during our virtual worship experience. As always, we pray that you share this message with your friends, and I hope that you receive a rich blessing from the Word today. Enjoy the service.
Grateful today for your goodness. Thank you, Lord, for being an awesome God to us and for us. Thank you, Lord, for answering prayers before we can even think to pray them. Thank you, Lord, for being our absolute provider. Thank you, Lord, for giving us everything that we need, even, Lord, before we even know that we need it. We have so much to be thankful for. And Lord, let us never forget to just take a minute or take a second to say thank you, because you are truly good. There's so much going on and things are really kind of crazy, but Lord, the absolute truth is we are not left without hope. For every day that is difficult, for every trial that is trying, Lord, for every moment that is hard, and for the times that we can't see what could be next, Lord, thank you for already having a plan in place for all of us. Lord, COVID did not catch you by surprise. None of our circumstances caught you by surprise. So, Father, help us to begin, if we've never done it before, but again today, to do a great job at just trusting you and just allowing you to be God in our situations, because you can be trusted. God, I lift up before you now every person that's under the sound of my voice. Father, bless those within our congregation who are struggling Bless the sick and the shut in. And then, Lord, bless those within our community, Lord, who are sick and shut in and who are in need. And then bless, Lord, those across this city and in this state and in this country, Lord. And God, please bless our world. We know that you are the sovereign God. And we know that we don't come to you asking for things, hoping that you can do it. We know what you can do because you've done so much before. So God, we pray with confidence. We pray with expectancy for you to walk through these, through our homes and intervene in our difficult situations. God, thank you for being so reliable. God, give us what we need. And Father, most of all, create within us clean hearts and renew within us right spirits and loving spirits and kind spirits and forgiving spirits. Lord, please bless us to desire more than anything a right relationship with you. God, please forgive us of our sins. Please, Lord, forgive us of our sins. And Lord, please save us when you come. We thank you for who you are and for what you've already done. And Lord, we are excited to see what you're going to do. We pray these things, we believe these things, and Lord, we hope these things in the matchless and mighty name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Everyone say no,
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 clap your hands,
no.
represents our partnership with God. God wants us to remember that our money and blessings come from Him. Because we want God to be first in our lives, we return the tithe to God before we pay our bills. This act of faith says that we trust God to care for us and make the remainder of our money enough for our needs. This repeated miracle of God's blessing strengthens our love for God and our belief in His active interest in us as managers of His money and material possessions. You may return tithe, give an offering, or make a donation in the following ways.
You've been good to me down throughout the years. It's a miracle that I'm still standing here. All that I am is because all that you brought me through. And everything I survived, it's all because of you.
Let's pray. Dear Lord, thank you for this opportunity to partner with you in the spreading of the gospel. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you.
I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. This is times of difficulty as people are not in church, but in their homes. But worship is where you are. Jesus can be in your home, he could be in your car, wherever you decide to just praise him, he's already there. We serve a God that is everywhere. He's all powerful. And because of that, we want to welcome you to the Longview Heights Seventh-day Adventist Church virtual worship service. We're thankful that God is still speaking a word of truth in these times that we're living. We know that the Holy Spirit is leading people to have a deeper relationship with him. And because of that, we want to share God's word. God's word is a powerful tool that changes our hearts, makes us closer to him. And it's important for you to study the word of God for yourself. But before we open up God's word, let's spend some time in asking him to guide us. Father, which art in heaven, thank you for your love to die on the cross for us. Thank you for your promise that you will never leave us nor forsake us. Guide us as we study your word and give us power to be obedient to your commands. In the matchless name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. I want to ask you to turn in your Bibles to the book of Acts, chapter 17 and verse 26. Our message is entitled, Every Nation. Every Nation. Acts chapter 17 and verse 26. And he hath made from one blood every nation of men to dwell on all the face of the earth, and has determined the pre-appointed times of their boundaries of their dwellings. Bible says a word that is a global statement. It's a passage that Paul was not only speaking to Jews, but he was speaking to the world. He was not just speaking to Greeks, but he was speaking to the whole world. His message was a message saying what God is doing, how God is working things out in this world that we live in, not only in the past, but even today. And he had made from one blood every nation of men to dwell upon all the face of the earth, and has determined their pre-appointed times and the boundaries of their dwellings. God is saying something to us. He's talking about who he is. He's the one that's made it. He's the one that's established it. He is the one that is the ultimate responsible for all of this world. And he's in charge of it. He is. He's made it. He's not only made it, but he's made it one. He's made of one blood every nation. He's made of one blood. He made it to where all the people are related. All the people have the same blood. All the people on the earth have the same God. And he is determined. I like that part. He has a plan for our land. He has a plan for our country. He has a plan for your family. He has a determined plan. He has thoughts that he's already put in play for you. And they're so awesome. And we can't always understand his plan. His ways are not always like what we think. His ways are higher than what we can imagine. And yet at the same time, he shows us much of what he wants us to do through his word. The New Testament in Paul's day was divided. The Jews did not like to spread the gospel to the Gentiles. The Gentiles were anyone that was not a Jew. And the Jews felt that they should hold on to what they had, and they were the only ones that had the truth, and no one else should have it. There was a division. If you were a Gentile, you were not even allowed in the synagogues. If you were a Gentile, you were looked at by the Jews as less than a real child of God, and you had to go through so many hoops to become a Jew, and they had these restrictions, and the world, the New Testament world, was divided. They had put up walls against their religion, and they made these walls a way to divide themselves. They tried to look different from the Gentiles. They wanted, and then the Gentiles probably had some views against them as well, because whenever you show this type of prejudice, whenever you show this type of segregation, then you split yourselves from your brother or your sister. And the Jews had this problem. They couldn't understand why Paul was going to preach to Gentiles. And even the apostles had some issues with it. Why would Paul spread the gospel to people that were not Jews? It was just unheard of. It was something that they didn't do. And I would like to say today, in our country, the United States of America is still divided. There are two Americas, two healthcare communities in America, two educational organizations in the same nation, two economical situations in the same nation. There are two justice systems. All we have to do is look at the Black Lives Matter that marched in Washington versus the insurrectionists that tried to take over Washington and how they were treated. We can easily see there's two justice systems in our country. There's two views of history. There's some people in this country that still believe that some kind of way they believe that the South has won the Civil War, that Jim Crow is still active, that people can do whatever they want to do and say whatever they want to say and treat everyone with disrespect that they want to. There is a historical, distorted view in this country. It's two lifestyles that we live, two lifestyles of where some feel that they can have privilege and live whatever way they want to, and to say whatever they want to say and go wherever they want to go, while others sometimes will even down themselves and believe that they're not on the same level as others. There's two lifestyles that we live, and it is dividing our world. It has already divided us so much so. It's not just divided in Washington between the senators, but it's divided in our communities, whether it's in Memphis or Mississippi, whether it's in California or New York. There is some divisions that we have in our country. These divisions are of our own making. You see, in the beginning, God created us one. In the beginning, God created us to be one group of people, and we were to work together and to love one another and treat each other with respect. But sin has divided us. Sin has made us set up fortresses, and you're either in the camp of the right or the camp of the left. You're either trying to follow one leader or another leader, and sin has divided us. Sin always divides. Ever since sin came into the earth, when Adam and Eve sinned, Adam and Eve were divided. He blamed Eve. She blamed the serpent. When their children came into the world and sin divided them, Cain was so angry with Abel that he killed him. Sin divided the Noah and the antediluvians, the people that lived before the flood, and only eight people were able, decided to live on the ark, while God washed away the rest of the world. And it's because sin always divides. Satan is the inventor of sin. He's a progenitor of sin. Satan is the one that has caused, he was the first sinner. Jesus was talking to some church people in John chapter 8 and verse 44. He said, "You are of your father, the devil. The desires of your father you will do." He was a murderer from the beginning, and he does not stand in the truth because there is no truth in him. When he speaks a lie, he speaks of his own resources, for he is a liar and the father of it. Satan is the one that has introduced sin into humanity. Satan has introduced sin because sin is completely against the law of God. Sin says, do whatever you want to do. All the nations have sinned. Every nationality, I don't care what color you are. I don't care where you're from. Sin is genetical. It has been passed through our genes, our chromosomes, our cells. And as soon as you're born, you have these views of sin. The Bible says in the book of Psalms, chapter 51 and verse 5, "Behold, I was brought forth in iniquity, and in sin my mother conceived me." Yeah. You and I are just naturally sinners. You can't get rid of that. You can't stop that. I can't change that on my own. Sin is what divides us. It's what makes us talk about somebody else, makes us look at someone else and curse them, makes us want to forget about God and his love for us. Sin does that to us. It distorts us because, the Bible says in Revelation chapter 3 and verse 17, "Because you say, I am rich, I have become wealthy and have need of nothing, do not know that you are wretched, miserable, poor, blind, and naked." Revelation chapter 3, verse 17. I don't have time to deal with all of them. I'm just going to deal with the blind part, the distorting. The problem with our blindness is that we don't even know that we're blind. We think we can see. Sin does that to you. Sin makes you think that you're right. Sin says, I don't see nothing wrong with doing that. Sin always is distorted because you're not looking at God, but you're looking at yourself. And everybody knows that I is always the middle of sin. There is a distorted view of creation. Charles Robert Darwin taught evolution by natural selection. He was convinced that evolution was progressive and that Caucasians were more advanced than Africans. He described racial hierarchy. With his teachings, many people that have believed him believe that just because you are a black person, that somehow you're not on the same level as a white person. There are people that have distorted views of creation. Their view is that Earth came into existence by chance, and just by chance, some people are more powerful, are smarter than others. Some of these racist actions are inspired by a distorted view of creation. Creation is important for us to understand that in 6 days God made heaven and the earth and the sea and all that in them is. And God created man and woman from the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life. When we understand creation, we understand that in 6 days, God made everything that we see. And on the seventh day, he rested from all of his work. And when we have that view, then we don't have the same distorted view of the evolutionists. You cannot be an evolutionist and a creationist. They would say in Oklahoma, you can't run with the hares and holler with the hounds all in the same night. Jesus would say, no man can serve two masters. He will hate the one and love the other. There has to be a decided view of what you believe. Your views on creation makes a national declaration. Your views on how God has created the heavens and earth will determine how you treat your fellow man. Your views of creation will determine the way you face life and the way you look at yourself and the way you look at others and your views of life. Black history is a way that says, I'm looking at God as my creator. And regardless of what we go through, we know God is still on our side. He has brought us thus far on our way. Why? Because he is our creator. He's our creator. And if you have an erroneous view of creation, then that's going to affect every part of your life. The Bible says in Acts 17, verse 26, our scripture passage, and he has made from one blood every nation of men to dwell on all the face of the earth and has determined the pre-appointed time and the boundaries of their dwelling. Sin will have you to distort, has a distorted view of the commands of God, of God's commandments. Some religious people believe that if you don't look like them, you're not a neighbor. If you don't talk like they talk, if you don't have the same kind of eye color that they have. Some church members believe if your skin color is not the same as theirs, then you can't worship together. Jesus said, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. This is the first and great commandment. And the second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commands hang all the law and the prophets. Matthew 22, verse 37 through 40. Jesus says there's two commands that describe all of the commandments. First, love for God. See, when you love God, then you don't have another God above him. You have no other God before him. He is ultimate. He is exclusive. He is the only one. He's above everything else. When you love God, you don't bow down to idols. You don't worship something else that is not God. You don't kneel to whether it's money or whether it's people. You don't worship something other than God. When you love God, when you have love for him first, then you don't take his name in vain. You don't use his name as a byword, as a curse word. He describes in Exodus chapter 20, verse 1 through 17, what it really means to love God. To love God first on the seventh day of the week. That you remember that in 6 days God created heaven and earth, the sea and all that in them is, and he rested on the seventh day. And because of your love for God, you spend time with him. You realize that the seventh day is the birthday of the earth. It's the time when we should remember and we should restore our relationship with God every seventh day. And that shows our love for God. When we love God, we will naturally love our fellow man. That means that we won't kill one another. We will honor our father and our mother. We will not steal. We will not bear false witness. We will not covet. All these things we do because of our love for God. When you really love God, then you will love your fellow man. Love for God makes you love humanity. When you really love God, it causes you to love God's family. I don't know about you, but my family is quite dysfunctional. But I love every one of them. I've got some crazy people in my family, and I'm probably one of them. But because We've been together for so long, and my mother brought us up all together. There's some traits that we have that are inside of us, and although we may fight with one another, we stand strong because we know that we have a love for one another. And that same love that we have for one another, we must have a love for all humanity. There must be a love that God puts into our hearts, and that love causes us to first love God, but also to love our brothers. I don't care what color they are. I don't care where they come from. Love cannot claim xenophobia. Love cannot claim white supremacy. Love cannot claim hatred and bigotry and injustice. Love is completely different from all of those things. When we really love God, we realize that we're one nation. We're one nation. It was difficult for many years for me to repeat the words one nation under God, because I realized that we're so divided. But when you have a love for God, it doesn't matter what country you live in. It doesn't matter what language you speak, what type of hair you have, or even if you don't have any hair. But when you love God, you love him regardless, and you love people that are bought and made in his image. And our scripture text says, and he hath made one blood, every nation of men, to dwell on all the face of the earth, and hath determined their pre-appointed times and the boundaries of their dwelling. Unfortunately, sin will distort your view of the cross. Grace becomes disgrace. Sacrifice becomes a spectacle. Forgiveness becomes fraudulent. Mercy becomes minor. Iniquity is a mystery, but the cross is the power of God. The cross is God's way of bringing us back together. The cross is God's way of reaching out to the sinner and bringing the sinner close to God and changing his character. The cross is God's way of taking men and women that have separated themselves from one another and have decided that they're not going to talk to one another, but the cross brings them back together. And the cross has such an amazing power that to the Jew, it's a stumbling block. And sometimes to the Greek, it's foolishness. But to those that love God, it's the power of God. Something about the cross that changes my mind. Something about the cross that when I look at his cross, his wondrous cross, when I peer at what he's done for me, his love to die for me, it changes who I am. That's why the old prophet Isaiah said in Isaiah chapter 53 and verse 5, he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and by his stripes we are healed. There's something about his sacrifice. There's something about his demonstration of love, that his love came into my life while I was down. Now, he didn't wait till I got better. He loved me as a bad person. He loved me in my prejudice. He loved me in my bigotry. He loved me in when I was not following him and I was doing my own thing, and he still loves me, and that changes me, and he takes the punishment of my sins. The punishment of sin is death, and when he died on the cross, he was saying to you and to me that I love you so much that I'll take the ultimate punishment of your sins. The Apostle Paul had to get in on that in Galatians chapter 2, verse 20. He said, I am crucified in Christ. Nevertheless, I live. But not I'm living, but Christ is living in me. And the life that I now live, I live by the faith of the Son of God who loves me and gave himself for me. There's something about the cross that changes you. And it takes people that are in two different camps and brings them together. I can't explain it. All I know is that there's a cross. It's so powerful, it makes a difference in our lives. Book of Mark, chapter 8 and verse 34, Jesus said, if any man will come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me. Ladies and gentlemen, not only does Jesus have a cross, but you and I have a cross. There's going to be some situations that you'll face on your job that is a cross that you have to bear. Somebody knows what I'm talking about today. There's going to be some situations maybe in your community or somewhere in your life, maybe even in your own home, where you're going to have a cross that you bear. See, the cross is not an amulet that you wear, but the cross is an experience that you bear. And everybody's got a cross that they have to bear. The cross is what changes your life. It makes your character different, where you can love people that are not lovely, where you can speak kindly to people when they speak mean. When they call you a name, you can bless them. It's something about the cross that does not let evil overcome it, but overcomes evil with good. That's what I like about the cross. If you have a wrong view of the cross, you can't see Jesus reaching out and forgiving you and helping you and giving you another chance. The cross, at the cross, every nation is called. At the cross, he calls the people from every nation. I don't care if it's Zimbabwe or Iceland or someplace in South America or someplace in Mexico or the United States. Everybody is called. That's why at the cross there is no illegal immigrants. At the cross, all the nations of the world accept it. In the cross, it doesn't matter who you are, or where you've been, or who your mama is, and your people from the past. The cross accepts you just the way you are. Because the cross says, I love you. God loves you. God cares about you. God loves you so much that he gave his only begotten son. And if you believe in him, you can have eternal life. God is showing you at the cross that we are all one nation. We're not a nation because we're Americans. We are a nation because we're Christians. Hallelujah. When we're Christ, when we're Christians, then we can say that I am a part of the nation of Christ. I'm a part of his kingdom. I'm following his lifestyle. He's leading me. I love this text because it says, at the cross, you are pre-appointed. God already knows where you are. He already knows what situation you're going through. He already knows the problems that you're facing. And before you were born, he knew them. Before your mama existed, he already knew them. You are pre-appointed. He knows your credit score. He knows how much money you have in the bank. He knows the sicknesses that you have to face. He knows the trials that are on your mind. He knows the stressors that are holding you back. He knows the failures and the temptations and all the addictions that you have. And regardless of all that, he still loves you. Because he has pre-appointed you for salvation. Hallelujah. There's so many wonderful things about the cross. And it's not just for me and not just for you, but it's for every nation. The Bible says in our scripture text that you are determined. Maybe you've been trying to get away from God. Maybe you've been living a life that is wholly against what God wants you to live. God says, I'm determined. I'm going to save you. I know it's going to take some work because you're difficult. I know I'm difficult. The Holy Spirit is still working in your life. He's determined, regardless of your failures, regardless of the times that you've ignored his call, regardless of the times you said he doesn't exist, he's still determined to save you. Then he says he's pre-appointed the time. This is your time to serve God. This is your time to give him your life. This is your time to make your life change. It's going to be greater than doing anything else you do. Because this is when God does the change. This is when God works a miracle in your life. And all you have to do is say, yes, God, change me. The good news is that he is an expert in changing. He's a professional, and he always is able to change you. He says if anybody is in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things are passed away, and all things are become new. Maybe right now, you want to be in Christ. Maybe right now, you want to be every nation. Every nation that accepts him can be saved. Every person that accepts him can have eternal life. And his life is in his son, Jesus Christ. And he has made one, from one blood every nation of men to dwell upon all the face of the earth. And has determined their pre-appointed times and the boundaries of their dwellings. Right now, won't you pray with me and say, I want God to make me a part of his nation. His nation is a powerful nation. Right now, you can be a part of a nation that has existed throughout eternity. One day, when he comes back in the clouds of glory, every nation, kindred, tongue, and people, people that are yellow, or people that are red, or people that are brown, or people that are black, or people that are white, every nation will see him coming, and they'll lift up their eyes to heaven and say, look, this is our God. We've waited for him. He's coming because God comes for people that are part of his nation. And you become a part of his nation by, not by a vote of a committee, but by your belief in Jesus Christ. One blood, every nation of men to dwell upon the face of the earth. Do you want to be a part of his nation? Let's pray together. Father, we are so thankful that you have a nation that is greater than any other nation. A nation of those that love you. A nation of people that have given their hearts to you. So many times we have left your nation. So many people have decided not to even join. But right now, somebody wants to be a part of your nation. I pray that you'll reach out to them, oh God. As they just reach out to you, as they just call on your name, right where they are, let them know that now, right now, they're safe in the nation of God. Give them courage to live in such a way that the cross will change their character. And we'll give you the praise and the honor for it. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. And God bless you today. Thank you.
Before we end our service, I'd like to share with you our mission and vision statements. Our mission statement is reflecting Christ by connecting, helping, reaching, inspiring, serving, and teaching. Our vision statement is, at Longview Heights S.D.A. Church, we seek to connect all souls with the Holy Spirit, help the weak, reach the lost, inspire humanity, serve our community, and teach God's Word.
I want to invite you and all of your friends to be a part of our Friendship Bible class. In our health study, you will learn how to feel better, look younger, live longer, lose weight, feel great, and improve the quality of your life while making new friends. In our Amazing Bible Facts study, you will learn how to add years to your life. What happens when you die? Can you die before your time? Can your loved ones come back from the grave and talk to you? In our church history and Bible prophecy study, you will understand the book of Revelation, the last book of the Bible, about the coming of the seven last plagues, when water will be turned to blood, when painful and grievous sores will come on all those who receive the mark of the beast. Who gets the mark of the beast? The number 666. If you call and enroll in our friendship class within the next 60 seconds, you will receive a special gift for being one of the first to call. Call us now, 901-235-2033. That number once again, 901-235-2033. 901-235-2033. It's free.
Thank you, Pastor Horton, for that wonderful message. And now, let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, I pray that you bless this message, and I pray that you bless the ears that hear. Father, I pray that you be with all of us as we go through this pandemic, and I pray that you bring us all together safely again so that we may be able to praise your name. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Don't forget, if you desire prayer, Bible study, or would like to become a member, you can text Memphis LVH to 84576. You can also call us directly at 901-774-5431. And we hope to see you in person one day at 685 East Mallory. Thank you. Have a wonderful day.